Hello, everybody, and welcome to a very special episode of False Charge. This is episode 100.
Made it.
Yeah, I'm honestly a bit shocked we made it here. That's almost the two-year mark. I guess that means our actual two-year anniversary must be coming up in a few weeks.
Wow.
We're also agonizingly close to having 100,000 subscribers on YouTube.
Would have been
a lovely bit of serendipity if we could cross those two milestones simultaneously. But we weren't quite there. But if anyone listening or watching happens to have about 1,500 friends that they can get to sign up to our YouTube channel within the next hour or so,
I was about to say,
we can still make this happen.
We can make
live.
It happen.
Alternatively, if someone wants to buy us 1,500 fake subscribers within the next hour, I could also live with that.
You know? Amazing.
Ignorance is
not
bliss.
My
we
ideal
won't know.
Outcome, but yeah, exactly. Don't tell me that that's what you've done, but you know. We'll look the other way, okay?
Yeah, exactly.
Anyway, I am your host, Dom Preston, and I'm joined this week by Toddy and Lewis, as ever.
Hello.
And we also had Aniran jump on to join us for this 100th episode,
Hello.
So we had a full house.
Woo!
Cool, right. We're going to get straight into it, really. We have a little bit of a slightly different structure today, but not radically different. We are going to start off with a couple of phone reviews. We've got a bit of a Huawei special going on this week because we are ready to review both the P50 Pro and the P50 Pocket. Toddy has been testing out the Pro for a week and a half, 2 weeks now.
Yeah, about
like
that.
And I have had the Pocket going for a week or so. That is the new foldable. So we're going to be running through what we think of the two of those new Huawei devices. And then we are going to go into a little segment to celebrate the 100th episode, where we share our worst opinions. Each of us has prepared the best, worst, bad tech take that we have. An opinion we're kind of embarrassed to admit, even on the office Slack. and we will submit them to each other and to you, the listeners, to be eviscerated in the comments. Before that, we have a few bits of news to get through. And actually, we've got a good grab bag of some sort of standard fast charge, gripes and moans to get through in the news segment.
Nice.
I'm going to start with what really sums up some of the stuff we talk about in the show a lot, which is yet another OnePlus phone with yet another terrible name. So this is actually the third week in a row I've used the news segment to discuss leaks, talking about new OnePlus models with silly names I don't like. I cannot believe we're at 3 for 3 on this, but here we go. This week, the first spec leaks came out about the OnePlus Nord CE 2 Lite 5G.
Oh, no, come on.
That's too far.
Come on.
Dang.
I thought you were going to stop about two words short there. Like, it just carried on going. You're like, no.
So let's break it down. We've got a OnePlus. It's a OnePlus Nord. That means it's sort of the light version of OnePlus. It's a Nord CE. That means it's the light version of a light version of a OnePlus. It's the Nord CE 2, so it's the sequel to the light version of the light version of the OnePlus. And it's the CE 2 Lite. So it's the light version of the sequel to the light version of the light version of the OnePlus. And it's got 5G.
Yeah.
I mean, it makes sense when you put it that way.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know why everyone's struggling with this. It's pretty clear. I am desperately hoping that with all these different leaks we've seen about different names, actually all of the sort of tech leak space is just getting muddled up and there's really only like two phones, but
Please.
No one can agree on what
Please.
They're called.
Yeah.
Because as it stands, there are about 9 phones coming up this year and 8 of them are just different versions of the Nord 2. So I'm just desperately hoping it's not true.
Saying that, they had a similar thing with the AirPods. So for ages, everyone was rumored, they were talking about these AirPods and they were called the AirPods Pro Lite. And it was like, well, no, that means they're just AirPods. And they ended up being the AirPods 3. It's just like, come on, guys. I remember as soon as it dropped, I wrote a section in one of our articles. I was like, this is not a light version of a Pro headset, like headphones. It just doesn't make sense.
No way. Oh, yeah. I don't think anyone's done a Pro Lite yet. We've had Pro Pluses, obviously. But,
yeah. A Pro Lite.
I can't think of anyone crossing the line to a Pro Lite.
It'll cancel itself out.
Yeah. Don't put the, if you put the idea out there, it's going to happen. What else? Realme have confirmed that 16th of February is when they're going to reveal the Realme 9 Pro series. Specifically, the 9 Pro is what they're talking about. So there's already a Realme 9i. We kind of assume there will be a 9, just a flat Realme 9.
Oops.
But it's actually, that's the model. There's not really been leaks about, and Realme aren't talking about it. So they're definitely launching the 9 Pros first. We're not really sure if they are just not doing a 9 or if it's coming later.
There was,
or if it will be quietly mentioned in the Pro launch.
Yeah, there was weird timings with the 8 series as well in terms of the order of how they released them. So it might just be the same situation.
It's probably that. Anyway, it's also notable, if you haven't been paying attention to this stuff, it's the 9 Pro series. So we do also know there's both a 9 Pro and a 9 Pro Plus. This will be the first Pro Plus from one of the Realme kind of budget lines, as they really kind of stretch whether this is going to be a budget phone anymore at all. I think we've been told it's going to have 5G, an AMOLED display. I think there was some stuff the other day about heart rate tracking built in, which I didn't look into in too much detail because it just sounded very strange and I didn't like it, to be honest. So I didn't really want to know anymore. But yes, we'll find out more about Realme 9 Pro in a couple of weeks. What else? Google is clearly positioning itself to get ready for the Pixel 6a launch. One, because it managed to leak the name, probably accidentally, but you never know.
In quite amazing fashion as well.
It's a really confusing leak, even by today's standards. So Google name dropped the Pixel 6a in the table of contents for an adult coloring book that it sent out to Pixel superfans. Curiously, fantastic. Only in the table of contents. It kind of says on page 16 to 17, you'll find the Pixel 6a to color in. But if you turn there, it's not there. So they clearly, assuming this isn't all very clever and intentional, presumably they did mean to have it there. Then they took it out, but they forgot to update the table of contents.
Amazing. Absolutely.
It's all
amazing.
A bit muddled up. But either way, if you were in any doubt, this confirms they are working on the Pixel 6a pretty much. And at the same time, they have also just discontinued the Pixel 4a, which you can no longer buy, which also has the weird knock-on effect that if you're not in the US or Japan, that means there's no A series Pixel phone anymore. At least not one that you can buy new directly from Google, because we never got the 5a. The 4a has been discontinued and we're still waiting on the 6a. So outside of the US and Japan, as far as Google's concerned, all you can buy is a Pixel 6 or a 6 Pro, and there is no budget or mid-range option, which, you know, is clearly not how they planned it. I'm sure ideally they wanted the 5A out worldwide, but it has left their lineup in a little bit of an odd spot until we see the 6A, which, as I mentioned last week, is expected in late May. So we've still got 3 or 4 months to wait for it. It's not kind of like it's just around the corner from what we reckon. What else do we have? Oppo. This won't be a huge shock to anyone, but after the Oppo Find N, their sort of book-style foldable that has been pretty ravely reviewed, I'd say, it now looks like they are working on a clamshell phone, a rival to the Z Flip and, of course, to the P50 Pocket that we'll be talking about in a bit. But yeah, it's apparently going to be part of the Oppo Find series as well, which makes sense since their other foldable is an Oppo Find N. We're expecting it in sometime around Q3, which is interesting timing because that is smack bang around when we're going to get the Z Flip 4, probably, from Samsung. That's probably August, September.
Yeah.
So it's pretty directly going to be launching a competitor to Samsung's next Flip around the same time. We're also expecting to see a new Razr around then, maybe. There's been a few movements on there. So it does look like that clamshell space is going to start getting really competitive between now and the end of the year. Which nice. Everyone will know I love. And okay, finally, Apple has in iOS 15.4, it looks like after 2 years of the pandemic, Apple has finally updated Face ID to make it work with masks. It kind of half did this already, but only if you also owned and wore an Apple Watch. And I appreciate Apple would love it if every iPhone owner carried an Apple Watch with them all times. but they're not quite there yet.
No.
I mean, did you see the workaround? I think it was a CNET journalist. She figured out a way to trick it to do mask Face ID before the Apple Watch thing came in. It was literally when you set up Face ID and you have to do your head rotation.
Oh, yeah, I did see
it's
that.
Like covering half her face.
Yeah.
I don't know how she figured out that worked, but it worked.
Yeah. So you can fold a cloth mask in half and just hold that up to the side of your face.
Oh, that was it as well. Yeah,
and then
yeah.
You do your alternate capture, and then you do the other side of your face. So then, yeah, it's got a full vision of what you look like with a mask on. But it wasn't quite as secure, apparently, according to Apple.
I believe
that. Yeah, I think I'll go with that. So that's what kind of makes this so exciting, because they're finally like, right, we're not doing Touch ID in the display, okay, guys? So we're going to have to work something else out here. And that thing is, so obviously when you're wearing a mask, it covers up the bottom half of your face, and that's the problem that Apple's iPhones has had up until this point. But what they've done instead now is they focus just on the top half of your face if there is if you're wearing a mask. It doesn't quite work as soon as you update. I will say, actually, it's in beta at the moment. It's not out yet. 15.3 is the latest. But when 15.4 comes, probably in the next month or so, that's where people will be able to start using it. So yeah, you'll be prompted to once again reset up and rescan your face, because it's taking in more data points from the top of your face this time along, time around, so it can recognize you just from your eyes and your nose and your eyebrows and stuff like that. And there is an extra step for glasses wearers as well, because of this extra data. You have to scan your face with every pair of glasses that you wear. So if you wear multiple pairs of glasses,
thinking like cold climates, like if you wear a hat like in your day-to-day life and you wear glasses and you wear a mask, their face IDs are working
it's sweating and it sees that. So this is kind of the problem that people have realized that I've been testing out the beta so far, is that there are problems so if you use your mask with sunglasses, it's not going to work. Like, straight up won't work at all. You need to see your eyes. Glasses, normal glasses, if you scan them, it should work fine. But they have noticed as well, if you're wearing a hat, like a beanie hat or something that covers up a lot of your forehead, that'll also cause it to reject. So you might be able to wear a mask, but you still need literally everything else to be clear so that you can get the thumbs up from Face ID. What I don't know at the moment, I kind of tried to Google this, but I couldn't find much info, is that whether this will be allowed for Apple Pay? Because that still seems not quite as secure as having a full Face ID scan.
Well, that's the curious thing about it, is I do wonder how it compares in terms of security, because they could have always done this before, not through registering extra data, because I'm sure that's the bit that it's taken time to work on. But they could have always just basically said, if it detects what looks like a mask, it ignores the bottom half of your face, scans based on the top half, and if that's a match, lets you into the phone. That would undoubtedly be less secure.
Yeah.
And they obviously made, you know, another tech company, you could imagine basically giving you the option saying, do you want to enable this? It is less secure, but we'll give you the choice. Apple being Apple, and I don't totally blame them for this. They never gave people that option. So, and presumably that is why they've never done this before. They just thought it reduces the security level too much, because that 100%. Sounds, from my non-coder perspective, like a relatively simple way to set it up. This is the hard way of doing it. Presumably this is close enough to the security level of full Face ID that they're happy with it.
Yeah, you'd hope so anyway, if they're rolling it out in the next big feature update to everybody.
It's either that or they're just shrugging and going, well, we give up on making a secure version, we're just gonna roll with it. And
like, you want convenience, you get inconvenience, okay guys? Yeah. Something's gotta give.
I have little sympathy, because this is a hole they dug for themselves by ditching fingerprints when they had no earthly reason to. And everyone else has, you know, found ways to keep them on their phones and avoided this whole problem.
Courage.
They themselves, their iPads have.
They do.
Anyway, so, that's a different.
Anyway,
grumble that's a whole for different segment right
just
there.
As everyone is kind of widely wearing masks a lot less than they used to, finally they're supporting masks. So,
brilliant. Thank you.
Great.
Thanks, guys. Great job.
Right, let's move on. Let's turn to reviews. So we're going to talk about a couple of Huawei phones, the two global models in the P50 series. There is also a regular P50 in China, but we've not laid hands on that, so we don't have anything to say. But we have gotten to try out the P50 Pro and the P50 Pocket, which have both been given global releases. It's still a little, you know, tentative exactly where they are. Huawei's been very vague about the markets that the phones are actually out in. They've given us Euro pricing. We're in the UK. They're not out in the UK, at least not yet. Huawei won't confirm whether they will or won't eventually come out to the UK, so we're not really sure. they are available in some markets in Europe. I think Germany and Bulgaria both have them, but I don't know where else. And there's a few Asian markets. So it's a bit of a grab bag. And you probably, if you are genuinely toying with buying one of these, it really will be a process of going to the Huawei website in your country and seeing if the option to buy exists or not. And that's kind of the only way you can find out. Or, of course, you've got to import it from somewhere. But anyway, we have these two phones. We are going to take them in turns. So we're going to start off with the P50 Pro, which Toddy has been trying out. This was a phone that was first announced almost a year ago.
I mean, because it was like March 2020 that the P40 series, I think, came
to market. They were normally
kind of clockwork.
Yeah. February, March was the time. They often they did a couple of MWC launches for P-phones, I think, which is late February. Then they moved to their own events, which were usually just after MWC, I think. And then the P50 took a bit longer because it had a couple spring like teasers of the design and the name, but it took a few more months to actually drop specs. So it was
they were really struggling. Yeah, the number of times they mentioned it at various other Huawei events, it was clear that they were struggling to like the phone is kind of ready. Yeah. But we can't get it to you.
It's so on the way.
July. Yeah, yeah. End of July, they actually were like, we're launching the phone in China. And then it hit, I think, mid-August was when it actually came out there. And so it's, you know, basically half a year later, now the rest of the world or other markets, obviously not the US and stuff, is getting, well, this. The P50 Pocket, obviously, is a slightly different story because that wasn't even announced until right at the end of last year. So
people were kind of waiting. That one has come out much faster.
Yeah, yeah.
But so the P50 Pro... it's got the normal Huawei issues, which we're going to get to, but it also has this new one kind of hanging over its head, which is the same as the S21 FE had. This problem of, in a sense, this is a phone from a year ago coming out now. And that is going to kind of have some impact on how it holds up. It's using a year-old chip. It's got year-old camera hardware. So I guess my first question, Toddy, is does it feel like a phone from a year ago? Or, especially given we haven't had that many Huawei flagships, does it still feel like it's new and fresh? And especially, does it hold up performance-wise to what you'd want from a phone now?
I mean, the 888 4G is the only phone I've used with this 4G-specific version, which is kind of like, I don't think anyone else aside from Huawei is going to use this chip, but fine.
I don't think it was meant to exist until it became clear that Huawei was
a necessity, really.
Yeah.
Because I think in China, you can get the Kirin version, which we just don't get as well, the high silicon version.
Yeah.
It's performance wise actually benchmarks very well, and I mean it's an 888, so like any phone that you bought within the last few months that has an 888, you know it's a solid chip. So in that regard, for right now, yeah, performance is great. Like no complaints about the like general kind of grunt of the phone, and benchmarks very well, like I said. The model that the only version I've seen internationally is the 8GB of RAM model. There's a 12GB model in China, which I don't think anyone else is getting. But yeah, so general performance is fine. The display, first time a P series has gone to 120 hertz. So that's a nice upgrade. So there's like obvious like technical improvements and kind of expectations that it's meeting. Like it's an impressively, I'd say, lightweight and thin flagship. It's thinner and lighter, despite having a bigger battery than the P40 Pro. The design is pretty... I'm kind of just kind of finish up the written portion of this review. This is the Cocoa Gold. That is the name. And it's basically silver with a hint of gold, but it's Huawei used to do some pretty out there finishes. And even the P40 series has some really nice unusual looks to them. And this, I just feel like even though they have this dual matrix camera design, that's the kind of hook for the series, aesthetically, it doesn't really kind of like shout.
I mean, at least like colors. I miss the colorful finishes.
In China, you can get a pink one, I think called Charm Pink, and there's another color as well. But everywhere else, you're just really going to find the gold version, which is basically silver with a. The guys at Huawei said it has a hint of tea in it, which I guess is fair. It's like the weakest tea. So that's if you, that gives you an imagine a mirror like with those, a hint of tea.
Those charts on like what level you do tea.
Right in
the wrong corner of the chart.
It's like someone like literally
one
dipped it and threw it in the bin.
Yeah.
So that's how much gold is in the gold of this finish. The black gold one is actually quite nice because it just has gold accents around things like the camera, which I think looks quite nice.
I like to look at that one.
I've seen some people got that as their review sample. This seems to be the signature color internationally. So this is the one you'll see more of. And it's fine, but it's just not very exciting, even with this big, bold new camera system, which looks impressive. on first impressions. Beyond that, yeah, 120 hertz screen, but still kind of like, it's not full HD. It's like slightly higher than full HD, but not quite 2K. It's a weird resolution. But at 6.6 inches, I like the kind of size of the device, the hand feel, yep. and the weight is really, really nice. So they've packed a lot in there. It feels really like well built. No kind of, I was kind of worried that they were going to drop the ball on build quality this year. I don't know why, I just had this kind of fear. And it's, I think, something you'll probably touch on as well with your review segment. Like, build quality on this feels really, really good.
I guess, I mean, if anything, build quality is one of the bits they still have full control over. Yeah, whether there is an internal like thought process this way or not, you could kind of see them being like, well, let's nail the stuff we can nail. You know, we can do the camera, we can do the build quality. Let's nail those, because everything else is outside of our hands.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. I guess the camera is the bit to talk about next. It's like the
for a P phone, it's always what people want to know.
Yeah, yeah. It's not bad. Like, it's a very good flagship quality camera phone. Dynamic range, which is the kind of hot topic for the current generation of flagships in my mind, with cameras like the Pixel 6 series and the iPhone 13 range have both shown, like, dynamic range is where it's at right now in terms of how to differentiate and how to, like, lead in the camera space. And honestly, it's really good. It's very different processing to what I've seen from most of the other kind of high-end phones that I've used of late. But I like the style. It feels very natural and the dynamic range is really, really good. But it's a very specific look. It's, I guess, softer in terms of color palette, but I'm okay with that. So it's more of a kind of taste choice than any kind of technical limitation or advantage that you're getting here with the camera system in terms of the general shots it takes. You have up to 100 times zoom, but the 100 times is like on the S21 Ultra, like pointless. But the zoom before that point, you know, you've got a 10 times optical there. Really good. Incredible, actually, in terms of consistency between sensors, which is something Huawei's always been really good with.
Yeah.
It has this dual, like, I forget what it's called, like the spectrum, high spectrum or something.
The main sensor. Spectrum camera?
Something like that. I think that's what the Pocket
has, what an you ultra have. Spectrum. Okay,
yeah, there's something different spectrum-wise. But anyway, the main camera and the secondary, there's a monochrome in it and a color. I use the monochrome mode. It's very punchy, very stylized, and it's cool, but it's still a phone photo, and you can tell it's a phone photo. Like, it's not a matter of the sensor that you're using. It's optics, it's glass, it's lens at that point, if that's how they want to push that angle. But yeah, it's fine. I'd say the picture qualities beyond that dynamic range advantage feel very similar to the P40 Pro. The functionality feels very similar to the P40 Pro. There's some nice new editing features. A thing I mentioned to you the other day, Dom, was that they introduced with the P40 series reflection removal. And it wasn't fantastic, but it did work. And it's just not there now. I don't know whether that's a Harmony OS versus Emotion UI thing, which we can touch on as well. But yeah, it's disappeared, which is strange. The thing I was really hoping for, which I always think Huawei is great at, is video on Android, because that's particularly weak on most Android phones versus iPhones, is just how their video is. The Pixel 6 and 6 Pro have issues in that area, mainly with like encoding and processing. Sometimes it's just jerkiness that shouldn't be there. This is better, but I had other issues that I'd not even seen on a Huawei phone before. And that, I was like, is that me? Is that a slip from the current state of the company? Is that the move to Emotion UI? I don't know what's causing that. It's a fixable thing for sure, but it's something that I've not noticed in terms of a drop in quality, I'd say, in terms of the video performance from a
So what kind of issues were you seeing?
It was color balancing that I was seeing. Also just like the jump between sensors when you're shooting video and you're recording and shooting whilst you're moving between those sensors, the jump's super noticeable. That's not so much of the issue. It's more the color balance. I had a static, almost locked down, it was handheld, but I was pretty much static shot of my wife in the garden doing some gardening, and she had a big orange coat on, and the color, it would go from like a washed out kind of peach to this vibrant orange just of its own accord, like flip-flopping. The lighting wasn't like particularly chained, like weird or anything, so I don't know why that was happening.
Right. I wonder with some of this stuff in terms of, say, the kind of software features you say have like dropped out, whether there are also any software licenses or patent licenses that Huawei maybe doesn't have access to anymore.
Yeah,
that kind of particularly sparked that, because that thought about the jumping between lenses, I know, is something that Qualcomm is bullish about as part of what it offers with the Snapdragon stuff. And I don't know the terms of the arrangement that lets them use 4G Snapdragon chips. But I don't know if it also gets them access to all of the software stuff that Qualcomm packages in with the chips. And maybe it doesn't. And maybe they lose some of that stuff when
also like
now,
some of the
I don't know.
The editing in the gallery tools just didn't feel as robust or as intelligent as I was expecting. And not even just for a phone like now or last year, just generally like from even like the last Huawei phones I used. So yeah, the software in terms of the camera experience was a little, that was the weakest part of the camera. The actual hardware I think is really solid. The functionality is great. The versatility of the lenses is great, but there's just some niggles that they need to address, I think, which they can, I think all of them can be fixed on this device. They don't have to wait for the next generation. But yeah, if it's a case of developing technologies that they lost access to and they have to build their own version, that it, I doubt that's going to happen in the next kind of...
Though who knows? To be clear, pure speculation on my part on that point. I've got no
But I had the same thought. So like
they've lost or anything like that.
I guess the other thing is Immersion UI. Like let's talk about that because it's not Harmony OS 2, which is what the phone I think in China is running Harmony OS 2.
They run Harmony OS in China, but global releases are all Immersion UI. It's Immersion UI 12.
Yes,
which is based on Android 11.
Yes, and if you run like benchmarking apps, it'll say you're running Android 11, even though Huawei software doesn't mention Android much anymore at all. No. The main thing for me that I kind of, versus what I remember from the last time I reviewed the P40 Pro, is just, Immersion UI 12 has the kind of, so bright on my screen. But like, I think Android used to do this, and iOS does this like now, obviously, but having the notifications and the kind of quick settings on the top left and top right corners when you swipe down from the top. Which I think Android on phones did at one point, and then they ditched it like a long,
some,
long time
some
ago.
Some still have it,
I
like
think some,
or like skinned versions, right.
Yeah. Some Xiaomi MIUIs have definitely had that behavior. I think Xiaomi added it, or maybe I'm thinking. I think Xiaomi put that into their tablet UI. The tablet version of MIUI that, does that.
Yeah, that I'm okay with that. That makes sense to me more so than this. But
that is something that was added in for Harmony OS. So when I tried Harmony OS on the MatePad Pro, when they first revealed Harmony OS 2.0, that was one of the, hey, here's this new thing we've done for Harmony. It has the split control center and notification tray. And when I first tested an EMUI, like the recent EMUI phone, which was actually the Huawei Nova 9 last year.
Yes, before I wanted to ask about your experiences with
it. It was exactly the same. And what threw me when I got that phone was I got it, I booted it up, and I was like, oh, wait, this says it's EMUI. It doesn't say Harmony OS. But using it, having used both, if it's not the same software, then I don't know what the difference is. And I do, I asked Huawei at the time, and I got an email back from them explaining from a back-end perspective the ways in which these two operating systems are different. And they were very open that EMUI was based on the Android open source project, and whereas Harmony was a sort of, built internally and rose out of Huawei's smart home tech. There has been lots of speculation about how much that latter bit is true and how much Harmony is really Android. Fundamentally, they've either built two different OSs with different code bases that are cosmetically identical, or it's the same OS, but they put a different logo in the about phone section.
I don't like either of those paths. To be true.
I know which way I go. I mean, to us, the latter is fine. Because,
yeah, the latter
for example,
is fine.
That's what OnePlus always did. OS and Hydrogen OS. It was functionally the same stuff, some tweaks for the Chinese market, and they called it Hydrogen OS there, Oxygen OS everywhere else. Cool, whatever, that's fine. If they're, slightly tweaked versions of the same thing. I don't understand why Huawei is so cagey about what the software is and where each OS comes from.
Yeah, I'd also posit that if they want it to feel different, it certainly doesn't. I don't know if if that was a goal. Like, they never actually explicitly said, oh, we want Immersion UI to feel unique and distinctly Huawei and stuff. But, if this is... if they're trying to differentiate or at least set themselves apart from the conventional Android phone experience that most people would know in the West, especially where Google is... on that experience, I feel like it would almost help to set yourself apart from that experience. And Immersion UI doesn't really do much beyond what we've seen from versions of Android that they did before with Immersion UI.
The only thing to me that
Android
feels really distinctive is genuinely as small as a color palette, which is EMUI has always had this kind of white and light blue color palette that as soon as I boot up an EMUI phone, I'm like, oh yeah, that.
Yeah.
But that's it. I agree. In a lot of the other ways, it feels, it still feels very under. And to be fair, I don't think that has to be a bad thing, because, you know, the other software gripe is obviously you lose access to lots of Android stuff. But hey, you know, from core usage, this is Android and it feels like Android. And if you're coming from an Android phone, great.
Yeah. I mean, we don't need to have the conversation about the app experience too much, because that's something that we've covered. Yeah. But I would say it's better than it's ever been in terms of Huawei doing all it can to mitigate the issues of not having access to GMS, Google Media, mobile services.
Yeah.
But, you know, of the 20 apps I installed, I think 11 were, it was directing me to APK Pure, this website where you download APK separately and then install them. And then the other like eight or nine were web apps, effectively. Just they call them instant apps or quick apps or something. And it even gives you a little, they've even added a smart quick app icon. Once it realizes that you're using quick apps a lot, it goes, oh, we'll put them all in one place. And there's his little hub.
Oh, nice. I didn't do enough of those to have that pop up, I guess.
It was really just all cool. For the Google stuff,
yeah,
pretty much. Like, you can get Google Maps. Yeah. You can get Google Maps as the actual app and install it and run it, but you can't sign in. So if you have shared locations and stuff. Yeah. So I can still use that for, like, bus times and stuff, which is kind of nice.
Oh, I didn't realize that. I would have tried that.
You can't sign into anything Google.
Linked to the Google Maps website. It's the sign in that's still a headache, because as much as I'm trying to get better about my password management, I still have some apps I sign into using Google Sign In, and not all of those make it easy for you to switch from that to an actual account with your own password login. So for those where all I do to log in is Google, I can't log into those apps on my wallet.
Yeah, you're like, well, I have no
I guess maybe I could go through every single one and figure out if I can set up an actual unique password login for that app, and probably most of them would let me, but it's going to be 10 minutes of work per app to go through and do that. And I guess if you're buying the phone, you'll do it, but still, that might take you an hour or two, and you're setting your phone up to go through and do this for all these apps, especially if you're someone who has historically done a lot of sign in with Google. All of those are gone.
And the other thing for those who are still like Huawei fans who are keen, like, maybe this is the phone that I can live with, like, who were hesitant before, a small thing that you might not think about, but then when you're living with it, you're like, oh, this is a bit of a hassle, is app updates as well.
Yes.
Especially if you're getting them from an external source like APK Pure, i.e. not through the Huawei app gallery, which most of the apps most people I'm aware of use in these markets, they're not on the app gallery. TikTok and Snapchat come preloaded on the phone. That's great. But Facebook, Instagram, WhatsApp, you have to get them from elsewhere. And yeah, if you want to update them, you have to then... App Gallery might notice and be like, oh, there's a new version you can download. But then it's a whole few extra, like, there's like 3, 4, 5 extra steps to update your apps. And it takes a lot longer, and it's, you can't do it passively in the background. You have to manually, like, accept the download and then accept the install. It's just clunky. And yeah, Huawei just, I don't think they can do anything about that. At least not with the current setup of their devices.
Yeah, I hope they do figure out a way to streamline that, because I think that would be, as you said, every time I've used a Huawei phone since the big break, it's gotten a bit better at handling the app situation. But that is, for me, the big... I can live with the fact that there's a handful of apps I still just can't ever use on a Huawei phone, and that's fine, and you can figure out workarounds and web links and stuff like that. But the updates thing, I think, now is the big problem they've got left. And yeah, I really want them to figure out better tools to notify you that updates are available without you having to go check, and to do more automatic updating. You know, I even found things like, when I was setting the phone up, it, you know, I've used a Huawei 4 or 5 months ago. So during setup, it offered to, you know, download my backup from the cloud and reinstall all the apps for me that I'd had on that phone, which is great. Except on some of them, it installed old versions of those apps. Because what it knew was that I had that APK installed on that phone 4 or 5 months ago. It didn't do it for all of them, but just enough to be like, oh, that's a headache. And I only noticed because it was one of the benchmarking apps I used. And I went in and realized, hang on, but I know this benchmark is on a more recent version than this. And then realized, oh, it's installed the version that was the latest 5 months ago when I reviewed the Nova 9. So it's little things like that it's got to figure out. I know it's a niche use case, backing up from an old phone. That doesn't happen a lot, but you know, that is part and parcel of the update problem. And I hope they're working on it. I'm sure they're trying to improve that. Yeah.
You did just remind me, actually, Android 12, and I think Google's involvement with the open source version of that as well. Android 12, they were they'd started working on having better support for third-party app stores, including auto app updates. So really what Huawei needs to do is maybe just upgrade to the Android 12 underpinnings, and maybe that'll make it easier.
Can't, because Huawei designed it all themselves. There's nothing to do with open source.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Sorry.
Sorry. To be fair, their open EMUI is Android open source project. So I assume kosher. It is getting an Android 12 update at some point, though whether they won't call it that.
We should ask, actually. I don't even know what their update plans are for this in terms of...
I haven't had an answer yet. Because I did ask for the P50 Pocket, how many years of software support they were promising, and, you know, as part of that kind of version updates with EMUI going matching Android versions, and I haven't had an answer back yet. So
running around in town and like, we hadn't thought about that. Oh my God.
Yeah.
But that is another part of the headache. It's functioning Android 11 phone, same with the Pocket. And that is true for many phones, but still, if you bought a new flagship right now, you would expect it to be Android 12. And even if it was 11, you would certainly expect to be guaranteed an Android 12 update very soon.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
And that's just not the case with these. I assume Huawei is going to do that update, but we don't know for sure, and we don't know when.
Yeah. And so, I guess, unless you guys have any more questions on the Pro specifically, I guess the summary is the design is lovely. It's small and compact and powerful. Battery life is great, by the way. Fast charging is incredible. 66 watts means you get a full charge in 45 minutes, which is awesome. Nice. And most of it's done in you can get day's use in like 15, 20 minutes charge easy. Which is great. Cameras are really solid, but except for like a couple of software issues that they can fix, but they aren't fixed right now. And the software has all the quirks that that we've identified before, they persist. And that is kind of out of Huawei's power, it would seem. The fact that they're still there and they're still kind of the same. No 4G and an older chip and an older version of Android and the price means it's a real tough recommendation, except for the most diehard of Huawei fans, despite it has loads of strengths. And if I just gave it to someone, they could see it was a good phone in terms of how it performs and everything. So it's as ever, bittersweet.
The
Foldy Boy.
Predictably kind of a similar story on the P50 Pocket. Even breaks down in some ways to the same kind of strengths. And it's funny, you kind of listed one by one the same things I would pick out as what I really like about the Pocket in a way. So here it is, P50 Pocket. I've also got my Z Flip 3 with me. So anyone on YouTube will see it is a bit bigger than a Z Flip 3.
It's way bigger than I was expecting. You showed that side by side.
Yeah, it's a chunk bigger than a Z Flip 3. It's a 6.9-inch display when it's unfolded.
That's a big thing.
Wow. Yeah.
Bigger than the S21 Ultra, for context. What helps is because it's a foldable one, because they kept it thin, it doesn't feel massive, even when it's unfolded and using it like that, partly because it's slim and it's relatively light. It's 190 grams, so it's actually lighter than the P50 Pro.
Yeah.
Wow. Just by 5 grams. But still, so you're getting this nice sweet spot, which I guess is the point of this form factor, where you are getting a big display, a kind of big ultra phone size display, but it doesn't feel big, it doesn't feel bulky, it folds down and fits in your pocket comfortably, or in your handbag or your purse or whatever. So nailed it on that perspective. And design in general, the big thing is the hinge. They call it a multi-dimensional hinge. What that really boils down I believe the point is it's about the they've got that trick that I actually think Motorola came up with first, which is the kind of water drop screen fold, where as you fold it, the screen doesn't just bend, it gets pushed into a crevice in the back of the hinge. So that's it doesn't crease as sharply.
The pedant in me is like, that's not multi. I feel like, it's X and Y. So fine, I guess you can call it
multiple dimensions, Toddy.
And that's really axis, not really a dimension, but like, fine.
It was designed by Doctor Strange. That's all you need to know, okay?
Yeah. It's got a mirror dimension, which is the finish on the outside. Can I ask, what do you think about the finish? I mean,
I'll finish up with a hinge and then finish. So hinge-wise, the two things that come out of this is one, how much it closes. So again, anyone watching YouTube will see this is the Z Flip and this is the P50. And it is much more closed, for lack of a better word. There is virtually no gap between the two halves.
I can't see one.
And that means, A, there's less room for stuff to get in that gap and scratch up the screen or things like that from your pocket. B, it just feels solid. This feels like a single unit. And that is exactly the way I felt about the Mate X2, which is their latest generation big book foldable, which used a different version of the same thing to achieve the same end, where it closes seamlessly. And it really does. This doesn't feel like two halves sitting next to each other. It feels like, yeah, this is a single block of phone that I can open up.
Lewis, how would you describe the hinge experience on the Mate XS?
Terrifying. Oh, it was the loudest, crunchiest, scariest thing.
I did laugh when opening the box for the Pocket, because there's a little sticker that kind of just has a couple warnings, like the familiar one about there's kind of a screen protectory layer, don't remove it, part of the display. And it also just says some noise when folding and unfolding is, you know, to be expected, or something to that effect. And I was just thinking, oh no, is it going to be a crunchy hinge
again?
Oh
no.
And it's not. Yes, there was a slight bit of noise, but it's not like that kind of grinding sound.
I was about to say, it was so bad that I thought I broke it when I went to the hands-on. I genuinely thought, first time I folded it, I was like, oh, I've just broken a $2,000 phone. Well, this is embarrassing.
It was very worrying. It really did sound a bit like broken glass. And you were like, oh no.
Yeah, just crunching under this being like, oh, I'm so sorry.
None of that. The other thing is the crease is very minimal here. And again, compared directly to the Z Flip 3, it's much harder to see the crease. When I find, at least, that when I'm using the phone, if I'm looking dead on, I can't see it, even on a white background. I can't see it's there. At an angle, you can. As soon as you start looking at it from an angle, even on a dark background, you can spot it. But that's not how you use your phone most of the time. And again, you can feel it when you're scrolling, but definitely less noticeable than the Z Flip. So immediately, hinge-wise, nailed it. There's room to make the crease even less noticeable than this, but we're getting close to the point where I'd be like, yeah, the hinge is done. There's not really room for improvement there. Actually, the only minor thing is this isn't quite as good at staying open at any angle. If you kind of have it at certain angles, it will stay up like that, but if I do that,
there's no flex mode.
So it's not quite as good as the Z Flip 3 and letting it just sit at 90 degrees and that kind of thing. So that's the next thing I like Huawei to catch up on. Does the hinge broadly very, very good. Just feels solid. Immediately, it feels better than the Z Flip 3. And that's saying something. Rest of the design, it's got the dual matrix camera design. Same as the P50 Pro. Here, it's one ring for cameras. And the second ring, as you can see, is a screen. We didn't really touch on that big dual circle design on the Pro. I have to admit, I don't really like it.
It's
I don't
fine.
Hate it, but I don't
it's
really like it.
It's distinct enough. It's kind of just like the Pixel big bar. Like you can see at distance what kind of phone it is because of that. Yeah. But I don't know if it's like pretty or anything.
No.
It doesn't do it for me. I certainly would say, you know, compared to the Z Flip 3, at a glance, I know which phone I like the look of more.
Yeah.
Totally.
Yeah, it's cleaner for sure on the Samsung,
It's not helped that, I don't like the finishes of this phone.
They're weird.
Three in China, because there's a black version in China, but that version isn't coming out globally. Globally, there's a white version I don't have, which is has a sort of dimpled diamond texture.
This is
the gold premium version, which is 300 like euros more. And it's a shade of gold I don't like. It's not quite blingy enough. It's got this horrible kind of waved texture. It's apparently inspired by magnetic fields.
Is it embossed? Is it like can you feel? Is it a texture?
Is it raised?
Yeah, there's a texture to it. The little lines are raised up, which has the flip side that it makes it a lot less slidey. It is a glass backed phone, and you know anything that solves that problem is always welcome. But I don't like the feel of it. I don't like the look of it. It's the worst fingerprint magnet phone I've used. You can see anyone on YouTube how grubby this phone looks, and I've been using it for a week.
Huawei does include a case with the P50 Pro because it is also a fingerprint magnet, so that's nice. I'm assuming you don't get one with the Pocket.
No case included. It's just a shame because it really detracts from how high-end the phone feels otherwise. My immediate impression, I got it out, I've folded and unfolded the first couple of times, I was like, wow, this hardware is incredible. Just using that hinge immediately felt this is brilliant. And then I started looking at it and I was like, there's already fingerprints all over it. I had it out of the box for 5 seconds. And
got to use it with gloves on.
It's a shame. Yeah. So I don't love the look. I appreciate that's the subjective bit. I think other people out there will probably, Lewis, you said yourself, you
love
really
it.
Do like the look.
I love it. Yeah. So
that bit's a matter of taste. Otherwise, a lot of this phone is kind of similar to the P50 Pro. It's got the same 888 4G, so last year's chip, 4G version. It's got a different camera setup. I'm going to get to that in a second. But my take overall on kind of what you're getting is a hardware package that in many ways looks almost like an answer to the Z Flip 3, though given the timing, that can't be the case. But it solves the problems of the Z Flip 3. Because the two big downsides of the Z Flip 3 are the camera's fine, but it's not great. And the battery life is actively quite poor. This has a 4,000 milliampere battery compared to 3,300 on the Samsung. And between the bigger capacity, and I don't know, maybe they've just got better power efficiency than Samsung, I don't know. Probably only having 4G rather than 5G helps. This is an all-day phone in a way that the Z Flip 3 is almost an all-day phone. This really is. This battery life-wise, it's a bit worse than what you'd expect from a non-foldable these days, but it's not dramatically so. I wouldn't say battery life isn't a strength of it compared to another phone, but it's not a weakness this time.
Yeah.
And the same is true of the camera. It's a good camera. It's not the best camera out there. I'm confident the Pro has a better camera system than this, that we haven't done side-by-side checks, but I would expect the Pro to be much better. But this is definitely better than the Z Flip 3's camera. So you're getting a weird setup. It is a triple lens. And there is also a selfie lens on the inside. But the triple lens on the outside is mostly what you'd use. It's weird because there are three lenses, but you only really use two of them. And we're familiar with that with like cheap phones where there's a depth sensor that you can't get at. And it's kind of like it's doing that, but it is a bit different. So the main lens is a 40 megapixel true chroma camera. You then get a 13 megapixel ultra wide, and then a 32 megapixel ultra spectrum camera. This is paired with some other sensors. Whoa. There's one that's like a 10 channel multi-spectrum sensor. There's a UV emitter. There's a couple other things with complicated science names I don't entirely understand that make up the rest of the camera setup. The rough pitch from Huawei is that this camera system, and I think primarily it means that third lens that doesn't do anything directly, this camera system is registering light outside of the visible spectrum as well as inside of it, and using that information to give richer color detail within the visible spectrum, such that you get more accurate colors on your photos because this stuff has wider color information than most camera lenses capture.
So like shooting beyond full HD frame size. So
beyond
you can
what
have
we can
stabilization.
See.
Yeah.
It's almost
stuff outside.
Capturing radiation and everything else. It's just,
I suppose that's
Wi-Fi signals.
Yeah.
I did hear that there's a special secret function of it as well, where it can tell you how much sunscreen you're wearing.
Well, makeup.
But not in this country.
Yep. So these are two of the other, that's one of the two other weird things it does use in this tech. So one, is this sunscreen mode, which is basically it's built into the outer display where you can use the little display as a mirror, but you can also within that do a sunscreen check where it is basically checking for the ways UV light bounces off your face on the basis that is different depending on whether you've got sunscreen there or not, which makes sense.
Yeah.
And it is registering that difference and will then color in the bits of your face. I can't remember which way around it is, whether it colors in the bits that don't have sunscreen or colors in the bits that do. But either way, it will show whether you have an even application of sunscreen or not. It works. I mean, I gave it a quick try and it seemed to do a decent job. It's a niche feature in a way. On the other hand, everyone does apply sunscreen. So in that other sense, cool. It's universal.
When summer comes round, 10 out of 10. I love that.
Yeah.
This feels like the feature that they went in with the better color accuracy first and foremost. And then they're like, oh, but because this tech is now in the phone, it can also do this. And yeah. so they're like, we'll make it a feature, I guess. They can't have gone in with like, we need a phone with a camera that can tell whether you're wearing sunscreen or too much sunscreen or something. Like, that's not the way around like cart horse situation that this would have done. So I kind of am more curious, as novel as that is, whether the color accuracy stuff seems to come across at all. Like, or does it look better?
It's obviously hard to tell on the color of the photos how much that lens is doing, because it's not a mode you can turn on or off, as far as I can find in the settings, at least.
The way it takes photos.
It's just that is just how it does photos.
Right.
You don't choose to use that camera or that mode. That extra lens is just there doing its thing.
Okay.
I think the photos I got out of this phone were very good. I think the color range was very good. I made a point of using it to take some photos of sort of dappled sunsets and the like, and it did seem to capture a lot of range in those colors and a lot of hues, and have a bit more subtlety to it than I would maybe expect. So I do feel like that probably is one of the strengths of this camera setup. I think that's fair. How much of a difference it makes compared to, you know, what you'd see in a phone like the P50 Pro, I'm not sure. There are also some downsides that come to the setup they've gone with. One is you don't get a telephoto of any sort. Presumably they could have put a telephoto in as that third lens. Instead, they've gone for this, which I get the Z Flip doesn't have one either. But, you know, if you're at this kind of spending, you might want or expect a telephoto. This doesn't have one. The bigger draw, downside for me, is there's no OIS, even on the main lens, which is a downside for video, but it's also a downside for night photography, obviously. And in night mode, definitely felt like where this phone camera dropped off a bit. And in daytime, sorry, and even in kind of dimish light, evening light, very, very strong. But as soon as it started getting into night, it dropped off. And particularly the ultra wide camera at nighttime was worthless, pretty much. That said, much better camera setup than Z Flip 3. The photos I got of this were genuinely very, very good out of the main lens. And if you want just a very strong main lens, this absolutely delivers. And it's obviously also got the perk of things like, because you can use that outer display, as with the Z Flip 3, you can use that as a viewfinder for the camera. So while the selfie camera on the inside isn't great, if you're only really going to use that for video calls, because I think if you actually want to take a selfie, you'll use the outer one. You don't get a lot of options. For photos, it just defaults into portrait mode when you use it. So you can set portrait mode to be the default settings you like, and then those will carry through, but you can't control it as you go. You can't do night mode or anything like that when you want to take a selfie like that. But you can record video, rear facing. You can do selfie video with the phone closed, which is nice.
Because you mentioned how the hinged, you can technically kind of position it at a half open position, but doesn't really stay there.
It'll stay there if it's sitting on a table or something.
Right. Okay. Yeah.
If you sat it on a table 90 degrees, it'll sit there fairly happily.
Okay. I'm assuming the UI doesn't have any sort of, on the main screen, any kind of features that kind of play into the fact this is a foldable. It's just that you can use the cover display stuff.
A couple do. The camera does the same thing Samsung's does, where if you have it at 90 degrees, it will move the camera UI to the top screen.
Oh, that's cool.
And things like that. I didn't find as many of those features flitting around the OS as Samsung did. I think maybe, I mean, give it time. Samsung's had three versions of that phone to get to that point. This is Huawei's first. But yeah, so far there's that. That's the only one I noticed, was the camera did react to being used that way. But that was it.
So on the outer screen, just comparing it to the Z Flip 3, is there any differences in terms of the functionality? Or are there any features you wish it would have that it doesn't?
They're very similar, really, which is to say they will serve as a simple, always on display. They'll give you some notifications. They give you some widgets, like a music controls or getting calendar stuff. That camera ability of you to go take a selfie. I'll say, I mean, I've already said I prefer the look of the Z Flip 3s, where it's kind of sat in there and it's a bit more discreet. The rectangular form factor of the Z Flip 3s is also in a way more useful if you want to do the photo stuff. Because while you can get some really lovely selfies from this, it's very hard to figure out your positioning in the frame when you're seeing a small circle, which bears very little relation to the form factor the camera actually users.
I was curious about that. I was already envisaging like, I'll learn over using the phone that if I put the top of my head, chop that off in the small screen, it'll be center frame in a portrait shot. That was my assumption.
Exactly. And so I'm sure people will get the hang of it over time, but I definitely found that when I was taking selfies using that mode, I would get the photos every time and I'd be like, wow, that has exposed itself really beautifully. These are lovely photos. But
I'm down here.
That is not frame
forehead, which is nothing else.
It just means things like you're not going to notice what's in the edge of the frame, the bits you want to crop out, the angle. Yeah. It might be even at a slight angle when you don't realize stuff like that. That's actually just kind of hard to spot. So that's a downside of the round display. It's a minor complaint, but yeah. The other weaknesses that are worth saying about this phone, just again on this kind of constant Z Flip comparison, but this doesn't have the waterproofing of the Z Flip 3. That is one clear area Samsung is currently ahead. And it also doesn't have wireless charging. And I do wonder if that is part of how they got the bigger battery in.
Yeah.
Wireless charging takes up space. Yeah. So that may well be how they were able to fit the larger battery in. And to be fair, if you gave me the choice, I might give up the wireless charging on my Z Flip if it gave me an extra 3 hours of battery life.
Yeah.
So I'm not saying, well, I definitely made the wrong choice there, if that is the way it, kind of the trade-offs go, but it's one to factor in that, there is a lovely convenience to wireless charging. Clamshells are actually perfectly suited to it because of the size, it's much harder to miss the charging spot on your charger. Mm-hmm. You're not figuring out which bit at the back of the phone needs to be there. You just plonk it down in the middle and it's definitely going to charge. But yeah, there's a trade-off there. And
there's 50 watts on the Pro, by the way, for wireless charging if you have the compatible Huawei charger.
50 watts.
Yeah, which is pretty cool.
Yeah, it's not bad.
Also,
what's the fast wire charging, on the Pocket?
Pocket is 40 watts.
That's still not bad. Still,
which again, it's pretty fast.
Yeah.
Faster than Samsung, so it wins that head-to-head if you want to look at it like that. And nippy. Not the fastest around, but nippy. I did forget to mention when we were on the camera stuff, there is the other silly mode they have is fluorescence mode, which allows you to take fluorescent photos, which is, sort of like UV light photos, the equivalent of getting glow in the dark shots or something. It's a bit of a cheat in a way, because the way they sell it is that this is thanks to the incredible strengths of the camera capturing UV light. Actually, partly what's going on is there is a little mini UV light in the flash module.
Funny that.
So it does just shine a blue light out, and then lo and behold, captures objects with all this blue light reflected on them. I don't know enough about the science of this to know how much the cameras are still working over time here to do this, whether you could put that little light on any phone and get the same results. I'm not sure. But yes, there is sort of I was expecting something amazing from the camera, and then actually it was like, oh, there's a little light there, isn't it? That's what's going on. Fine. Okay, I see what you've done.
I scrolled through some of your sample photos while you were talking about the camera section. I did see a few of these fluorescent ones, and I just thought the camera was a bit broken. They just do not look good at all.
It doesn't super work. It has to be taken in the dark, obviously, to get an effect off it. Because it relies on that little light, it will only work on things that are fairly close. Because you're not be able, you couldn't get that fluorescent node on a city nightscape shot because your little tiny UV light isn't going to make a difference to what's going on there. Some of the shots came out cool. Some other ones, actually, because I was quite close, the little light on it completely overexposed the thing I was trying to photograph. It's equivalent to taking a flash in a dark room and it ends up looking horrible.
That's what I've thrown on screen there. That's the one that I saw. It's just, the R2-D2. It's very, very blue R2-D2 everywhere. R2-D2. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah. So that is mostly white, that little droid. And it just came out overly blue, I would say. But you can also see how dusty my shelf is, embarrassingly. But, it's a cool photo mode. It's another one of those ones. It's like the little micro lens on the Oppo. It's fun, it's cool. You will play around with it if you get the phone. It does something no other phone can do. I'm sure there's a handful of people out there who can see it and say, I'm going to use that all the time, I want this. I think most people will say, I will forget that feature is there after a week.
If you're a nail artist that deals exclusively in UV colors,
there you go.
There we go. There we go. Perfect phone. You can thank me later.
But no, this is, I think my takeaway at the end of all this is very similar to Toddy's with the P50 Pro. This is a phone with a very strong design. I don't personally love the aesthetic, but a lot of other people do, but things like the build quality of it, the way the hinge is put together, incredibly impressive. It is genuinely a step above what Samsung has managed yet. And I hope this, you know, sparks more competition and development in that space. It's got a really strong camera for what you would expect in a clamshell foldable.
Mm-hmm.
It's got really impressive charging and battery life for what it is, but the chip's a year old. There's no 5G. It's got all the software problems we talked about before, and it's very expensive. Yeah. It's 1300 euros and it's 1600 euros if you want the gold version I've got, which also has more RAM and storage, to be fair, but still.
That's the point. Yeah, that's the point I was going to mention in terms of, in addition to all the flaws we've talked about, the fact that it is significantly more expensive than the Z Flip 3 that is finally becoming, getting that mainstream appeal. It doesn't
have that same attraction. In my head, it felt like a lot more. And the funny thing is, that's partly because it's a euro price. And in my head, I think of the pound and dollar prices. And actually, if you compare them and then factor in that the lower spec of this is 256 gigs of storage. So if you compare to the 256 gig model, then it's a 100 euro price difference. So it's 100 euros more for this. And honestly, if you told me for this improved hinge, for the better battery, for the better camera, 100 euros, I'd go, no brainer. Yeah, that's, you know, they've nailed it. Perfect. But it's just then when you factor in, okay, you're dropping wireless charging, you're dropping waterproofing, you're dropping 5G, and you're dropping Google.
Yeah.
And it's still 100 euros more. It stops working.
Yeah.
And even if you ignored the waterproofing and wireless effort, if it was just the dropping the 5G and the Google, I know it's outside of Huawei's control, but still, 100 euros more to not have Google and 5G.
Yeah.
It's always a hard sell. And they just need to come in cheaper to justify what they're doing.
Yeah.
Anyway, that is enough of that. I think pretty clear takeaway. It's the same thing we always say about Huawei phones, which is so sad, but phenomenal phones, both of them. Some little flaws, but both really, really impressive. But unless you have very specific ways of using your phone, you probably shouldn't buy one. And that is a real shame. But let's turn to our personal tech nonsense as we round out episode 100. We have each come here with one opinion we have that we're a little ashamed about or think we might be judged for. Or just, in my case, I'm a little unsure if I believe it or not, but I think I do, but I'm not quite committed enough to the cause to go for it. And I think other people will think I'm an idiot. Let's round through who thinks what. I want to start because it's I've had a couple, you know, spoilers as to what everyone thinks. And I know Toddy has come here with a take that is the antithesis to a lot of what we stand for here on Fox. He's going against a lot of what we've spoken for on the show at length over 99 episodes so far.
Well, I feel like I'm like the main proponent of like the people complaining about phone name structures, which you led this episode with so beautifully, by the way.
Yeah.
Not knowing what my segment was going to be at the time, which I love that. But it's that as much as I hate silly long phone names, I love the ridiculous color names that manufacturers pair with their phones. And it kind of, for me, it was galvanized by Breathing Crystal, which was a Huawei P30 series color.
It's so good.
That's breathing. Uncomfortable.
What does it mean? Why is it breathing? Like, so many questions. Like... Yeah, you know, it's not any of the questions I usually have about a device is why is the color breathing? But like that was, and then it kind of got me like looking into it and thinking more about like phones I'd already tested in the past and be like, oh yeah, that's weird. So I'll run a couple more of the ridiculous, the P series is a great source of
I was about to ask where Coco Gold ranks.
Yeah, Coco Gold is pretty out there. For this year, I'd say Coco Gold is pretty good. Also Golden Black for the black model. That's just called Golden Black. There was also Aurora on the P30 series, which is quite nice.
I like that.
The P40 series, their signature color, which is the one I tested for the P40 Pro, I keep reading it as Deep Blue Sea. It's Deep Sea Blue, but Deep Blue Sea.
Oh, they should have just gone all in.
They should have just gone all in.
Get Samuel Jackson in to do some promo.
I feel like you guys can appreciate why I love these. A little ad
where the shark eats a phone.
Yeah, there's like a brand tie in there. Yes, the movie came out like 10 years prior. That doesn't matter. Even the P10 series had that weird green option, which they just called greenery.
Is that what that was called? I remember that color.
Greenery. So I've got a couple, and as well as Huawei, the other kind of offender or champion, if you will, for ridiculous color names, I'd say is Google with the Pixel colors. Since I think the Pixel 3.
Yeah.
There's just a kind of air of sort of, I don't know, arrogance or just like...
I have the word arrogance in my head too. I don't know why it sounds so arrogant the way they name their colors.
So the Pixel sometimes. 3 colors were just black. It's just black, yeah, okay? Just yeah, clearly white, and not pink, even though it was definitely a pink phone. So just like, they're very combative, but I love that. It was like so many just strange emotions from just color names. And then they, with the Pixel 4 XL, they also had this special edition orange one, which was oh so orange. even though it wasn't the most orange phone out there, it had a black frame and stuff, so it was an odd one.
Orange enough.
And then, yeah, the Pixel 5 had sorta sage, not even sort of, sorta, like
sorta.
Very relaxed and jovial now with the color names.
Pick a tone, Google.
Yeah, yeah. So I've got a quick challenge for you with the outstanding colors I haven't mentioned yet. So these are not Huawei's and they're not Google's. You have to guess the manufacturer and ideally the model of phone.
Oh, wow.
So we'll start with an easy one, which is Aura Glow. Now, it's a very popular,
is that the Oppo Reno's?
But the Glow, they did use Glow in their names as well, yeah, to not? Be fair. Oh, so
they had
I'll
Reno
give you
Glow, didn't they? Point.
Yes, exactly.
Is it Nokia?
It's not Nokia, no. It's one of the biggest phone brands in the world. Mm-hmm. Clue.
Shall we?
Not Xiaomi. Bigger.
Samsung.
Samsung's Note 10 series. That mirror with the rainbow. That was called Aura Glow.
Yep. Yeah. Oh yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about now. Yeah.
You know. It was like mirror polish, fingerprint, awful for fingerprint.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, this one should be maybe easy to pin down. I'm not expecting the model number model for this, but the brand, I feel like you might be able to get it. Forbidden City Blue.
Forbidden City Blue.
It was a special edition color, so it is real hard if you didn't notice it. I remember getting hands up with the phone. Not Realme. It was for a while. It was one of the only 5G phones on the market back when 5G was new. So there was like the Galaxy S10 5G, and then there's this other. It was like their one play, and they kind of cheated because they it wasn't.
Reno 10, the Oppo Reno 10?
It's not Oppo. Let Oppo go, Dom. It's not Oppo. There's no Oppos in this list. It was the Xiaomi Mi Mix 3. The Mi Mix 3, which was, I think, was the one which
Blue.
Had... Yeah, it had the pull down, and then the camera's like, it was a you know, instead of a pop-up camera, it had the whole screen pulled down to reveal the front cameras.
Yeah, I remember.
A quick one. Aniron's best place for this one. I'll give you a clue. It's one of the gaming phone brands, but Electric Black. It's just a black phone. There's nothing electric about it. There's no blues or lights that I could see. Maybe there are lights when it's on. But yeah, you're going to guess the brand.
Was that a Red Magic?
It was a Black Shark, I'm afraid. Black Shark 2 Pro with electric black. And then the last one is two colors, if you can call them colors, onion and garlic.
Oh,
you said there was no Oppo.
Well, it's not Oppo. I mean, yes, it is Oppo, I guess, if you're technical about it.
Sure. It's the Realme, it's the Master Editions.
Yes. It was the first Master Editions, I think, the Realme X series. Naoto Fukasawa, I believe, is the designer they keep working with. And he usually picks a material, which we've talked about in the past. He's done like brick and cement, and he's done paper
and, one. Yeah, exactly.
But yeah, I think the first one, it was the Realme X, it was onion and garlic. And they just had this kind of weird mat.
I think those
are glorious. And I want more ridiculous phone names, phone color names to continue. But also make the phone names themselves simpler, please.
I mean... I will say, I think the smartphone industry has cottoned on from the nail varnish industry, because I've heard from people that this has been a thing for a very long time. So I've quickly Googled a couple of the popular nail varnishes. There's one, it's an OPI one, it's pink. It's called Crawfishing for a Compliment, which I think is absolutely great.
I love a kind of like play on words pun type vibe as well. That's
there's
nice
another
too.
One called Let Me Buy You a Drink, Tiramisu for Two.
Ooh, that's a nail polish color. Wow. Yeah.
My vampire is buff. What color is that? Please tell me.
No idea.
I'm going to go purple. It's some sort of dark purple. That's my guess.
I'm going to go on the website.
That also reminds me of like Farrow and Ball, the fancy paint brand.
Yes.
For like your home painting. Mm. They, I remember once they had like like desiccated salmon, and then there was like dead rat, which was like very like off brand for them.
Do a great little quiz of what's a Pharaoh and ball paint and what's a Games Workshop Warhammer paint.
Oh nice.
Dead rat absolutely sounds for like sure, it right? a Warhammer paint.
Yeah,
they had the same thing, you know. They had paints called like Orc Blood Green and stuff like that, and everything.
Maybe for next
gnarly.
Fast charge, we'll do a phone color name, brown. A paint color name, a nail polish color name, or a Games Workshop paint.
So I think the takeaway 200. Here is silly color names good, but they could be sillier.
They could.
Yes.
Be.
Oh yeah, sillier than Breathing Crystal. Yes, please.
Yeah. All right. Let's go with Aniron.
Yes. Okay. So mine is that I think more phones, not all phones, but they should bring back the bezels on some phones.
What do you mean, Aniron? This is craziness.
What I mean is, right, we're doing our best job while we wait for these under-display fingerprint scanners to come out, under-display selfie cameras.
Yeah.
We're kind of making do with kind of the teardrops with a big notch in the case of the iPhone or like a hole punch. And I just think every time I've tried a phone which has got like a nice slim bezel, say like some of the Sony Xperia phones or some of the gaming phones, they have a nice kind of slim top and bottom bezel. I think it looks quite nice. It works better in landscape mode. And I just think we don't need to sacrifice the bezel completely in order to get these kind of super high screen to body ratios and to get this kind of like hole punch thing. Eventually, obviously the end goal is to get the under display selfie camera, this is actually really good quality, and then that will be an all screen design. But in the meantime, it feels like we're giving up too much. And then when I go back to these phones, I think, yeah, I like this. So
I'll put it to you, I half agree with you, but it's because I actually have always thought we should go back to pop-up cameras, because of all
you
of the solutions, I've
that.
Always they thought so pop-up good. Cameras were the best, because they let you have the full display. You let you have a good camera rather than these rubbish selfie cameras that are trying to fit through the tiniest gap in the screen they can make. So they have to be small sensors and small cameras, and they suck. Pop-up cameras, I always thought, were the best answer to the problem up to when we got to under displays.
I guess if Samsung can make its foldables water resistant, maybe they can figure out a way to make a pop-up mechanism water resistant as well. Mm. And
I know that was the headache. That was the reason they died off, really, at least part of it. And I think, to be honest, I also think a lot of consumers and phone buyers just didn't like them. Either they thought they were silly, you know, 50-50 when I showed a friend one of those phones, they'd either think that's cool or what a load of crap. but also people just worry they're going to be fragile, they're going to break. And it doesn't matter how many times you tell them, oh, the camera retracts when you drop it. People still, myself included, don't trust that makes you nervous when you hear that you're gonna have a bit of fragile bit of plastic protruding, and that if that breaks, your phone's done.
In terms of like keeping the bezel, I think the only brand that comes to mind that is in a big way is Sony with the Xperia range, which you touched on, Aniron. And I do really like the simplicity of the solution. Like they've walked an odd line. They're keeping it thin. Like clearly they're evidently trying to keep it thin. But that is at the expense of the selfie camera, considering their phones are all about camera quality. The front cameras are absolute garbage, relatively speaking, to the rear cameras, which really is disappointing, because I'd rather they went, I'd be okay with a little bit more. You don't need a lot of extra space to make a slightly bigger, better sensor in there. And keep some bezel and have a better front camera as well. But so I guess if a company did it right, I could get on board with it. But otherwise, I'm for better quality under display camera stuff, especially after reviewing the Z Fold 3 and how atrocious that was. Yes, please.
One of the other challenges with the bezel thing from my end is, I don't want to go too like Ice Universe about this, but symmetry in bezels is nice. And yes, there's reason, you know, if you have the top bezel because you think that's a better way to handle the selfie camera, I kind of get that, and I'm sympathetic to it. Problem is, if you have a top bezel, you've got to have a bottom bezel, because otherwise the phone looks weird.
Yeah.
And suddenly you're giving up screen space for no good reason, or making the phone taller for no good reason. And again, that's part of the problem Sony's in, where they have these phones that are really tall and thin. And it's partly because they've chosen a display like aspect ratio that does that. It's also partly because they've got to have half a centimeter of bezel on either end.
Yeah.
But if it could look nice to just have the top bezel, I think I'd agree with you.
Mm.
The fact that you've still then got to give up more space on the bottom of the phone to make it look aesthetically pleasing, that's where it gets me and I go, I'm out.
My only counterpoint to that would be that if it would give you room to have front-facing speakers, and obviously that the audio experience on many phones isn't really up to scratch, if they actually used that extra space and maximized it to improve the audio experience as well, I think I would be willing to compromise.
Yeah, I do not care one jot about phone speakers. I'll be honest. But I appreciate for a lot of people that is not the case. And certainly if you're gaming, say that's one good way to watch a lot of stuff at home, not on headphones. So yeah, I get that actually. To be fair, there's a specific demographic that works for. And to some extent, that is Sony's demographic. So I can see why they've stuck their guns there. For me personally, I'm like, no, that doesn't add anything I want from my phone.
Mm-hmm.
But we all seem to be in agreement that the current situation is not quite where we want the phones to be, though. Screens look a bit weird and selfie cameras are rubbish now. So,
And this is progress?
How about you, Lewis? What do you got for us?
So, mine's obviously Apple-related. Surprise, surprise. I don't know if any of you remember, but a few years ago, there was something called 3D touch technology on the iPhones. Yeah. It stuck around for a few years.
Was it the 6S that brought that in?
Yeah, it was something around there. And then they ditched it again. I think it was around the iPhone 10 or 11. They were like, right, no more of that. But I'm so gutted because I don't know whether it's just the nerd in me that just taught myself how to use this properly when it first came out, like so I could make the most out of this display technology that could register the pressure that you're pushing on the screen. I mean, that's a bit of me. So it would let me do things like, you could quickly preview text messages without saying that you read them and expand notifications and pop open pictures and stuff like that. Just general little bits and bobs that would speed up the overall iOS experience. I loved it. Nobody else even heard of it, essentially. No one knew it was a thing. So then Apple were like, well, let's save the money, let's ditch it, and we'll go back to a normal just long hold to access the same things. And that's fine, but it's a little bit slower and it doesn't provide that really satisfying pop sensation that you used to get when you used to do it on the iPhones. I used to sit there and just squeeze the screen and just feel that pop.
I hated that tactility. I have to say, I never really used iPhones around the time 3D Touch was there, but I did review one of the 8s maybe that had it. I hated it. I hated the way it felt. It felt wrong. Pressing hard into a glass surface that doesn't move getting this fake
tension
bit of like,
here right now.
I really just didn't have the feeling of having to push hard on a piece of glass to get a little fake rumble at the end of it. And whereas a long press where you can still be like gentle with the phone, you just hold your finger there for a second, is more natural to me, more intuitive. Genuinely, it was almost painful like pushing. And I something about it set me off. To me, it was the equivalent of nails on a chalkboard. It was this thing that was like, I hate this. I don't want to do a 3D touch. Like something about this just rubbed me the wrong way. Really unpleasant sensation.
I was just before that iPhone launch, but they'd already, I think it was like between the phone being announced and the phone launching with that feature, like actually going to market, Huawei put out the Mate S, I think it was. And I got the special edition from the Chinese, like from the Chinese team had come over and they were showing off the Mate S range. And one of the features was it had this thing called, they called it 3D Touch at the time. Yeah, and then they rebranded it because they got in trouble. I presume they had
literally the same name. Yeah.
One for one. Right. But the way they marketed it was hilarious because they're like, you can weigh an apple. They put an apple on the phone screen. It didn't work for the record. Like, I tried it. It didn't work, but I love that they were like, that was their ambition, was like, this is a useful feature or useful way to use this feature. I think I prefer what Apple did with it, but I don't know whether it was better than a long press like iOS now just does. And I think, to Dom's point, I feel more comfortable just long pressing than pushing into my expensive phone screen.
Yeah, I get where you're coming from for that. I think for me, it all just comes back down to I always accidentally activate either my torch or my camera through the shortcuts on the lock screen of an iPhone, so it will be forever on in my pocket and it's really annoying. And that used to be one of the 3D touch things, so you'd have to push onto the screen to access that, and if it was just a tap it wouldn't do it. So I used, that was probably my favorite thing because I could really control when I wanted to access these things, and now it's just if I put my hand in my pocket it's just accidentally turn the torch on or something like that. Or I've taken 20 pictures of black while it's been in my pocket. But, you know, whatevs. It's fine. It's fine. No one else agrees.
Yeah, I mean, I have to say, I think that's one of the Apple things that is deader than dead.
I'm okay with that being dead. That could
stay
dead.
Yeah, I'm not bothered with that.
Yeah. Gone then. Bring us home.
Right, okay. So, I mean, my take is bad in the sense that it might well be internally contradictory. but I think both that most people should spend less money than they do on phones, but also that as a kind of society, we undervalue phones and are too quick to call phones too expensive relative to other bits of tech that we use. So to explain that a bit more, that last point is one that I've shamelessly stolen from Ben Sinn, the XDA developers writer. But basically, you know, we sort of bristle at a phone that costs a grand, but are happy to buy laptops for more than that. People buy luxury handbags and shoes far more than that. Things that do a lot less and are much cheaper to make than phones, we happily spend a lot more. And in a way, I think of a phone as a bit like it's like the whole thing about a mattress, you know, the things you should spend lots of money on and you're like, yeah, not go cheap on, and like your shoes and your mattress. And I think in the modern era, the phone is one of them. It's like
the stuff,
yeah,
you use every day. Like, yeah, yes, it's £1,000, but if it lasts you.
Yeah. Exactly. Like, if you are on brain, that phone 4 hours a day, every, yeah, day for several years, there's no harm in going and spending a decent smashing amount on something. Yeah. The flip side of that is, I think the current way the phone industry is structured and what ends up costing more in the market means that while I'm saying everyone should feel free to spend more money than they do on phones, equally, no one should be buying flagship phones, because actually you can get all you need from the mid-range. Yeah. And even below sometimes.
Yeah.
And actually the thing is that what we're paying more for are essentially the luxury nice to haves.
It's more a state of like how I guess phone economy works and stuff. But I'd rather people bought an expensive flagship that is great. It's mainly for the software stuff, the long-term support. I'd rather than buying a mid-range or a budget phone, unless you were super budget, yes, and you know it might die, or it's, you know how long it's going to last you. The expectation, I think, is totally valid at the flagship end. Anything below that, I don't think you can. That's where some of the money goes. You're paying for that long-term,
yes,
support.
Yes, it's one of my big frustrations that brands still, and I get why, but they do tier their software update
so
prices
annoying
based on, yeah, the price of phones. And so someone buying a cheap phone, it will not work for as long. And, yeah, that is so frustrating, because actually, in all other respects, the way flagships are priced is to reflect that they have luxury features like wireless charging or, yeah, like periscope cameras that are not a core part of how you use your phone. You know, when you're looking at what the jump between a £700 phone and a £1,000 phone is, 9 times out of 10, you're paying £300 for a periscope lens. And it's, yeah, like, cool, if you're going to use that, great. Those are expensive, delicate bits of electronics that cost, yeah, a lot of money, and I can see why there's a real premium attached to them. The average person does not need a periscope lens, and that's not to diss periscope lenses. They're cool, and for the people who love them, great. The average phone buyer does not need to drop several hundred on a periscope lens,
no,
but they should drop several hundred on software updates.
Yeah.
But why are they being made to? Like, that pricing is screwy.
Yeah.
I guess I still think that if you're going to spend, let's say, a grand on a phone, that I would want it to last longer than a couple of years. Like, so with the other, yeah, examples of a mattress or a pair of shoes, they're going to last years and years.
Yes.
If I'm then still replacing my phone, yeah, after spending a grand, that's an issue. And that, yeah, people want to, and I guess the market geared towards you upgrading to the new version.
Right? Yeah, and it really is only Apple right now who I think validates that particular aspect of their, yeah, pricing.
Yeah, Apple's the rare case. You know, it's rare I have nice things to say about Apple, but I do think in terms of that, they get the way I see this, which is that, you know, you should be spending enough money to get something that's good and that will do all the things you need to do, and there's a false economy in buying really, really cheap ones. And, you know, when you're reviewing a really budget phone, it's so deeply frustrating because it's a horrible experience a lot of the time if, say, depending on which bits they've saved the money on, so the chipset and things like that, if there's not enough RAM. And so I see why, you know, people should be willing to spend more. And I appreciate there's always going to be some people who just can't afford even a what we consider a mid-range device, and that's totally legit. Sure. You know, I have friends who are firmly middle class, who have earned more than me, you know, decent incomes, live in London, but they still balk at spending more than £200 on a phone. And it's like, why? You use this thing all day, every day. Just buy a good one.
Yeah.
You know. But then the flip side is the industry is just set up badly for that, because buying a good one doesn't necessarily answer the reasons you should buy a good one, which is it will do the day-to-day stuff much better and it will last a lot longer. And that's really where spending more should get you more return. And outside of Apple, it doesn't.
Quite a thinker you brought to the table, Dom, versus like my like silly color names are fun.
We're a diverse podcast. We cover all.
Yeah, absolutely.
All takes are welcome here. Okay, let's wrap it up for there. Thank you to everyone who's been watching and listening. I cannot believe we've been here for 100 episodes. I obviously hope we'll be here for 100 more. So we will be back in slightly under 2 years for Fast Charge episode 200. So even if you don't bother to watch the show ever again, until then, just pop back for number 200, please. And, you know, we'll have some more awful opinions ready and waiting for you. So yeah, thank you to everyone who's been watching, listening, whether you're a new listener or viewer or whether you've been with us since the beginning. And thank you to Toddy, Lewis, and Aniran for being part of just the big tech advisor team that has made this possible. And yeah, please, we don't say it all that often, but remember to go check out techadvisor.com. That is where we spend most of our time doing written stuff. We have an awful lot on phones and all sorts of other stuff. And we are reviewing all sorts, a lot more than we get the time to talk about on the podcast. So there's loads you should go and check out on that if you're interested, including P50 Pocket review is on there. And Toddy's P50 Pro review will be on there very soon. So if you want to read more in-depth thoughts on those, please do go to the site and check it out. I've waffled on enough. So thank you and goodbye.
Bye.
Bye. Yep.